Well, hello. I'm Eric Breau. I'm from France. I work at Machina Corpus. And here is my talk, We Plone. And there is a subtitle, which is Psychoanalysis of a Community and Psychology of Developers. First of all, a disclaimer. I cannot guarantee that the thing I'm going to explain make any sense, right? So you've been warned. Don't complain. What it is about? It is about our feelings, right? How do we feel as developers? How do we feel as contributors, as members of a community? We feel stuff. We are humans, right? We do technical stuff, but we are humans. So we have feelings, and it makes a lot. So let's start with first thing, why do we contribute, right? Why do we do that? We already have a job. We'll get paid for that, but we choose to contribute. I don't know if you ever try to explain that to someone which is totally not in open source, right? Totally not in software development. Right? Imagine you explain that to your father-in-law, gonna say, yeah, we contribute because it's a better model, it's a good organization, I'm gonna do something, and someone else gonna get it for free, that's for sure, but it might correct stuff, and I'm gonna get the correction back. I might have some improvement, and also if people that do not share, they might tell me something is wrong, blah, 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 blah. And depending, I mean, the guy gonna just think that you work for free for people you don't know, right? That's what you do. Okay, simple. Well, depending on the kind of guy is your father-in-law and how he consider yourself, he might think that you are either stupid or generous. Okay? I mean, right? Well, actually, it's not that simple because it's not about the money, right? There is a song from Jessie G, I don't know if you know. A nice song. I love this song. She's really right. She says, it's not about the money. We just want to make the world dance. That's actually really true, actually. So I'll be quoting philosopher later. For now, I quote Jessie G. I think that's a very valid point. Actually, the question is, why do we work? We work for three reasons. Livelihood. It means we need to eat. We need money so we can buy stuff. We can buy food and clothing. That's for sure. First thing. We also work for existence. Existence means we need to be part of the society. We need to be somewhere. Okay, so that's also something your job is providing to you. And last thing is consistency. And consistency is basically the need to have a shared ideal, to feel that you are part of building something, participating in something. And that's true for any work, any job, right? And actually, consistency matters a lot. There have been a study a few years ago that only 16% of employees would recommend their company's product. That's terrible. That's a disaster. That should be something political people should address right now. That's horrible. Yeah. This study was in France, so it might be different in other countries. Because we French people, we love to criticize everything, right? We criticize stuff we don't like, of course. We criticize also stuff we do like, actually, like ourselves, our country. And we also love to criticize things we don't even care about. So, okay. But still, I think this number, this figure is very important. And something which is very interesting about community is that 100% of community members would recommend that product. Why is that? Because if they would not, they wouldn't be part of the community, right? So it does make a difference. And here, I'm going to come to a notion which is quite interesting. Those two Latin words, osium and negotium, are opposite, all right? So osium is leisure, right? It's free time, is the time you have. It's not holidays, right? It's about the time you take to take care of something, take care of yourself, do sports, do this kind of stuff, take care of people you love, take care of anybody, take care of, I don't know, culture, etc. This is osium, right? A time for caring. And negotium is the contrary. Negotium is not to do osium, right? So very opposite of it. And negotium have been derivated, and now we know about negotiation, right? Negotiate. This is the activity of business. And you do have the same notion with business in English. You have business mean you are busy. You are not free. You're not available. So you're not available to care about something or about someone, right? So this is actually interesting because, yeah, when we think business, we think about, yeah, we are having a job and doing our business, right? So that's basically. But words means something. And business, it's quite negative. Negotium is quite negative, right? So basically, it would prove that business equal not caring. Sounds kind of exaggerated, right? It's not true. People, when they are at work, they don't feel like they don't give a shit of anybody, right? It's not true. But let me give you an example. My customer finds a bug in a software I've been doing. That's so boring. As usual, he complains. Something's wrong. Wow, wow, wow. But a complete stranger from the other side of the world thinks there is a bug in my last night commit. Wow, cool. And I want to fix that right now. I mean, in the middle of the night, no problem. I'm going to fix that. Wow, strange, no? Well, so actually, yeah, business means you don't care. And not business, assume, means you do care. And we do feel more responsible, right? We have a stronger responsibility feeling when we do open source compared that when we work for a customer who is actually paying us. Yeah. When we work for free, we are more committed than we work for money. Why is that? Does not make sense, right? Well, here I come to another concept, which is from Immanuel Kant. So I'm going to try to say the name of the book. It's Was ist Aufklärung? thank you. So it means, what is enlightenment? That's a very, very famous book from Immanuel Kant. And he develops this concept of minority and majority, right? Minority is supposed to be the state of children, right? And majority for adults. But this is more complex than just age, right? The minority is the fact that you are in a state of dependence, that you're not free. You're not able to take decision. And you are, unfree. Unfree. Free software, ring a bell? Well, that's minority. And majority, the contrary, means you are autonomous. You are autonomous, you can make decisions. And something quite interesting he has developed is that the fact you are actually major is the fact you are a major, a scholar, someone who knows, who have knowledge, who have been learning stuff among other scholars, right? And it's quite interesting, and I'll be back to that later. So we developers are grown-ups, right? We are. But the software industry tends to reduce responsibility with all the management, whatever it is. It could be software quality or whatever. We try to reduce the responsibility of the developers. Developers are just coders, right? We don't trust them to take decisions, that kind of stuff. That's the global approach of the current software industry. I don't mean all the company. All companies, I guess, are different. But more generally, that's the way it works, right? And actually, communities, open source communities, do the contrary. They try to value the grown-up status of the developers. And when you are in a community, you're actually not facing clients. You are facing other developers. So you mean you are a coder, someone who knows about code, among other coders. So that's where we go back to this notion of majority. We are grown up having a knowledge being able to make decisions and discussing with equal people. And that's something which magnify our responsibility level and our responsibility awareness. That's why we feel more committed being in this kind of group rather than being in a private company, right? So that's the point. And well, makes sense to say that only grown-ups can be parents, right? Do software need parents? That's actually a good question. Well, let's try to analyze how we write software. Writing software is not something classical regarding regular production, okay? This is a process which takes time first, and it is a full process. I mean, you go from the very beginning of the creation of the software to the delivery, and you are the guy who's doing everything. So that's something which is a long process, and you're gonna iterate over the code, you're gonna change the software, you're gonna have several versions and so on. So that's a long process. And this process, to me, induces parenthood. It means we do have feeling for our code. It's not just something you don't care about, because we spend time with this code. And we want it to be good. We want it to be better. We want to fix flaws. We want to fix bugs. And we want to feel proud about it. And we want to feel proud about it, mainly if we are showing this code to someone. If my customer does not look my code, I don't care much if it's ugly. But if I send it to my open source community, I know people are going to read it. And I know people are going to say, ah, it's not cool, it's not nice, not done the right way. And I don't want to do that. I want them to be happy about my work. So I really developed this feeling of being proud about my code. And that's something which leads us when we write code. And we want also, we want it to be prepared for the future. So that's pretty much like a parent would do with a children, with his children, right? In English, we run a software, but in France we say we walk, il marche, okay? And as we learn our children to walk, we do the same for our software. So that's a very very close relationship we have, and we get really involved in that. For instance, when I've been developing Rapido, I was really, really into it for a long time, and it was really focused. I think I lost 3 kilograms. And yeah, well, it was quite good. And now, after the Christmas period in France, we eat a lot, and sometimes my wife is like, maybe you should start a new open source project, don't you think? Yeah, well, I might. Well, and my other project I've been working a lot on is Plomino, my first project on Plom. And Plomino is now 10 years old. It's quite a big one now, 10 years old, but it's still waking up me at night. While my actual children, when they were 10 years old, they were not waking me at night. And I'm okay with that. I mean, Plomino wake me at night. Oh, sure, I'm gonna take care. I care about it. I care a lot. That's my kids, right? So if we are the parents of our softwares, what are communities? Well, my point is that communities are adoption structures. The thing is, we make sure with the community that the software, we always have loving parents to take care of them. That's what the community try to do. We are not the original parent of Plon, right? We're not. Just, I mean, maybe few of us was there at the very beginning. But, so the original fathers went away. But we are still here, taking care of Plon, making sure it works. And we do have, I guess, the same feeling about Plon that the original ones, the original developers, add with Plon. So the Plon community makes sure we get this responsibility feeling about Plon, right? So this means we are not just a bunch of developers who share codes, right? Well, not just that, we do share the code, but it actually works like a family. We're gonna have, the community gonna evolve, it might grow, it might or not, and new members gonna come up, and those members, we're gonna welcome them. And it means that we trust them to raise the software, to guarantee the future of the software, right? So caring about the software as a developer, you feel like a parent for the software, implies that you care also about the community because this is a family, okay? That's the people who are gonna raise your kids with you, basically. So that's a family, and so we do care for each other as a family, right? And now I go to another concept. The fact is how we build our identity. Well, the I needs a we. You cannot be yourself by yourself. It does not work. It does not exist. So there is a concept which has been developed by Simondon, which is about the psychic and collective individuation. It means that becoming myself is a process. And this process is both individual. Okay, you're going to have some thought in your mind, etc. You're going to have events happening to you. But it's also collective. That means your identity is a mix between you and the people around you, right? And so belonging to a group, and we belong to many groups. We belong to our actual family. We belong to our city, to our country, to our company, to our communities. There mean many, many, many different groups. And all those groups make you, a unique person. So you cannot be unique without with other person, right? That's quite important. So you can say that me, is just a phase in this process of individuation. So this process never stops until you die. And at every given moment, you are a phase of this process. So you can see it just like an immutable state, like in React, see? That's immutable. And you replace the state every time something new comes, right? That's how it works. So I needs a we, and this we is the community, right? And so we actually feel the need to be part of Plon. We want to be Plon. We want to be in Plon. We want to be in the Plon community. Well, let's turn it that way. We want to be Plon. Because we understand that it provides us with very good things, and it participates to our identity. And so this desire to be part of Plon, part of the community, is actually the communities. I mean, if you just take the contributors, put them together, they're just a bunch of developers sharing code. But the fact that they do want to be a community, make it a community. That's how it works, right? And that's what makes the community more than the sum of the contributor. It is the sum of the contributor plus the desire they have to be something more than the sum of the contributor. So this is the moment where the community start to be something consistent, actually, something who does exist. And consistency, I mean, in a certain way. For instance, ghosts, they do not exist, right? But it does not make them inefficient. They consist. They consist in our mind, in the mind of several persons, right? While Plon consists as well. Plon, the community, has a consistency on this way, right? That's quite important. That make Plon something like a person, right? It's a group of persons, but it start to have an identity, a psychology. It start to be something, just not a group of persons, but an actual being, right? So that's the point where we can say we Plon. We is Plon. There is a concept which has been developed by Bernard Stiegler, based on the Simondon concept originally, which is trans-individuation. Trans-individuation means that this process of each person becoming himself through the rest of the person can go in both sense. So there is a transylvidation of all the different groups, and all the different person into this group goes to this process of transylvidation. And basically, Plon participate to our we and of each of our I. I don't know if it's clear, but Plon, as a person, Plon going to provide me a part of my identity. And the fact that it gives me this part of identity builds the identity of the whole thing. So that's where we can actually say we Plon. I know it's not really clear, but sorry. That's actually how it works. And this being, this Plon thing, it's not thing actually, is actually has two outcomes, two outputs. There is Plon the thing and Plon the concept. So first, Plon the thing. Plon the thing is the actual code, the actual thing, the software itself. That's Plon the thing. And we know it. We can read it on our laptop. That's Plon the thing. And while it's just code, it's not perfect. There are a lot of bugs, a lot of defaults, a lot of flaws, etc. That's what Bernard Sigler would name a tertiary retention. It means it's something which is real, material thing, which is the result of a transylvidation process. So all technical objects are actually tertiary retention. A book is it, but also this table, whatever. All the things that a human have been created are tertiary retention. And Plon is just that, a product. And Plon the concept is different. Plon the concept is what we think about Plon, how we see it. And actually, it's a moral ideal. We see it as perfect, it's flawless. We have a very high expectation about Plon. We want it to be perfect. We want it to be tested. We are very proud of its security, of a lot of things about it, because we are idealizing Plon. This is Plon the concept. This is, and it works, like it's actually very efficient because it pushes us to do it better every time. That's what Freud would name a superego, Uber-ich in German. And that's the Uber-ich of the community. Plon, the concept, is this the common moral ideal of everybody, of the Plon community, right? And it is actually stable across time. It's because what we name it actually metastable, because it's moving. It's always, as I said, like an immutable state, which is replaced every time. This is part of this process. So it's stable across a collective memory. So as I was saying, even if the first contributors are not here anymore, this Plon concept is still here. And it's something which is not exactly the same as the initial Plon concept they had in their mind when they have been starting Plon, but it does have a memory of it. It's a common memory. We do have the memory of everything about the past. We do have also wishes for the future. So this is what Plon the concept is. What we think about Plon, how it is, how it was, how it will be, this is this concept. And it has a strong knowledge of its origin too, and so which is Zop. Well, might say maybe we have reached a point where we need to kill the father. joking. That's about the end of my talk. And just to say, I'm not philosopher nor psychoanalyst at all. And so this talk is potentially a total fraud. May I say total fraud? But I can still answer one question. What does keep Plon going? I know. Love. That's it.